You can start, doctor.
Yes, so when it goes to birds and bee, I have made three categories, general categories, where you won't find them in any book. Nobody actually has said anything about this, but it's just me what I have observed. One is those people who go to watch birds, they carry binoculars, they carry notebooks, they carry a bird book with them, some bird app in their mobile. And that is one category, only bird watchers. The second is bird watchers come photographers. I mean, they are basically bird watchers and doing some photography also. They have a binocular, they have some camera, bridge camera, or maybe a consumer lens. These people to make a note at what they see, they upload these sightings on social media, on scientific media also. And the third is hardcore bird photographers. These people usually use pro-level cameras or consumer cameras. And these people might skip a few sightings if they feel the bird is not coming in the open, not getting a few good photographs. They'll skip it and concentrate on getting good photographs. Of course, there is always an exception for each of these categories. Now, when we go out for bird photography, usually this is what usually you should have along with you. Some basic gear like a lens, a tripod or a monopod and a binocular. The binocular is very important when you are dealing with birds, either bird watching or a bird photography. Binocular gives you an insight about the bird's position, the bird's presence, and then you can decide upon the approach for watching or photography. And you should be prepared to go along with some few like-minded photographers who can always be an asset to you. And some gears actually. This is basically from my Andaman tour. Whole lot of lenses there. This is one on the extreme left is the 500mm Canon. And then the next is the Nikon 500. That's my lens, 100-400 Canon. Then this is the 400mm F4 Duo Canon. These are the 200, 500, 150, 600. These are all lens. And using this lens, basically you have to decide what sort of photography you are going to do. What is the limitation of your gear? Seeing a 500mm lens with me, one who is having 150, 500 or 100, 400 need not feel bad at all. It is just that you should know the limitation of your gear and then you can decide accordingly what sort of photography that you are going to do and what you are going to get. With a less focal length, you can get something like this also. This is also very important. A landscape actually showing the habitat. The next comes is once you see a bird, how to operate your bird.
Doctor, 1 minute. Just a second. Nandish sir, I think you just need to check the internet connection because I think, can everybody see Dr. Sudhir's screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. So I think everybody can see.
I can see Dr. Doctor's face, but I can't see okay. The presentation screen.
Maybe you can rejoin. Rejoin. Just try and see rejoin. Okay. Yeah. You should be able. Okay. Doctor, you can continue.
Pinpointing a bird, basically. And then trying to approach the bird, which is very important. It's easy to approach a bird when you are in a forest area. You get a lot of heights, natural heights, tree, barks, branches, whatever. But when it goes into the open, it becomes very difficult. Now this is a photograph that we clicked in DNP, Desert National Park outskirts. And this is Dr. Atul Deshpande, who usually comes with me. And he is trying to approach actually the bird. And this is what we try to get ground level shots. Ground level shots, I mean the photograph that you click, the angle is very important for the viewers to watch the photograph that you click. So this sort of thing, you can get a good ground level shot. This was clicked in Jamnagar. This is a wetland area. Hello, somebody else is presenting.
Yeah, Dr. Amrit. Kunte sir, I think your screen sharing is on.
I think I'll have to go out and come again.
Yeah.
That's right. You are in. So just be careful of that present now button. Do not click on the present now button.
This is approaching birds in a wetland. Now here I am going to share one more trick. This is what usually people do when they approach a bird in a wetland. But I did something else. Not in this tour, but in the previous tour, we practiced that. What happens is, wetland birds, if you try to approach them, they try to maintain a distance from you. A particular distance between you and the bird, they'll always try to maintain. The more closer you go, the more far off that they'll try to move. What we did was, we had two guides with us. One was watching the bird from a binocular, and the other, as you can see in the screen, just a leg. What he was doing was, he was following us from behind, keeping us some distance between us and himself. The other one was far off. He was watching the bird and he was calling the second person. Arre thoda aage badho aur. Bird nahi dekh rahe, thoda aage badho. Then he used to whisper at us, chalo aage badho. And this is how we could move forward. This, what you are seeing is the very rare crab plover. Difficult here. It is easy in Jamnagar, but getting a close-up and good photograph is not easy. This was the distance that we could attain, we could achieve actually by crawling. And finally, ended up getting so close. This is a full frame photograph. It came so close that the whole crab plover could not fit in the screen. Yeah. Now, what next that you do when you see a bird? You have to frame a bird. Lot of people, what I observed is when they see a bird, immediately they start clicking, cut, 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 cut. They keep the bird at the center of the screen, and then they start shooting. Even if the bird is stable on a branch, they will shoot n number of photographs in a burst mode. And after reaching home, so many photographs are the same alike. So I have to delete now and keep a few. And then they are unable to decide which one to delete and which one to keep, because all photographs, good looking photographs, are dear to the person, and then it becomes difficult to delete the photographs. And deleting them also creates a lot of e-waste, which we have never thought about. We create a lot of e-waste unnecessarily. So what usually I feel, when you see a bird, try to compose the shot. This is a screen, actually camera screen, and you divide it into 9 parts. And these actually the outer third crossing points, you can say, outer third segments. This 1, 2, 3, 4, these are very important. If the bird is facing on the left, keep the bird on the right outer third below or above. And if the bird is facing on the right, keep it on the left. So there is some space in front of the bird, breathing space, what you call, and looks good composed. For example, this photograph. You see, the most important part of any object, a bird or animal or human being, is the face. You see where the face is, and there's a breathing space in front of it. This goes to wildlife also, to macro also. Now, I want to tell you about focusing. There are 2 types of focusing. So friends, before I forget, I just want to tell you this tips actually will be a part of it. About 10-15 minutes, we'll talk about it. And then I'll be sharing and showing you some photographs. So please hang on. Focusing is of 2 types. One is the auto-focusing and one is the manual focusing. But usually into wildlife, we are more focusing towards the auto-focusing part. Because manual focusing, you have to adjust the manual ring, and sometimes in the fast-paced wildlife photography, that becomes difficult and not possible. So auto-focusing, when we talk about auto-focusing, is of 2 types. One is the active and one is the passive. What is the active focusing? Active focusing works when the subject is relatively close to you. It works how a beam from your camera sensors goes and falls across the subject. It rebounds back onto your sensor, and that is how an image is made. That is how the sensor comes to know about the object, and it adjusts itself and focuses. What is passive? Passive is when the sensor tries to detect a contrast between the object where you want to click and the surroundings. Very easy to explain this. Try to focus your camera on a blank wall. A blank wall or a single colored wall of your house. Try to focus your camera. It won't focus because there is no contrast. Now try keeping something in front of the wall and focus. The camera will focus. So that is called passive focusing. Passive focusing and active focusing both the amount of light conditions to have this actually. So active and passive focusing are the two things we should keep in mind. You try to focus and click at night, it becomes difficult because of low light, the contrast is not detected. So focusing becomes a problem. Now we'll talk about the focus modes. And before that, I want to tell you about something about the clicking. You see an object and you try to click. Now this clicking actually also is about two types. One, you see something and you click and the click happens. That is release. And one is the other mode is the focus mode. What is the focus mode? You have to adjust. See, there are the settings actually which you need to do for this in your camera. The release and the focus click. These are the modes actually. So focus is what the camera will not click even if you try to click until and unless the lens and the camera focuses on a subject. And the release is what whether your camera focuses, your lens focuses or not, you press the shutter, the click will happen. Now focusing is of three types. One is the single AFS, that's a autofocus single point. This is usually used for a subject which is not moving, a bird which is stationary, a tiger which is sleeping, or anything that is standstill, not moving. Here you need to just acquire a focus and click. Once click, it's over. If you want to click again, you have to again half press your shutter, focus and click. The next is very important, especially for birders, bird photographers, and the birds that are moving. That is the AFC, autofocus continuous. Now in this, what happens is, and the bird moves, then you have to just move your lens, the camera and the lens refocuses again. The bird moves again.
Doctor, again. Doctor, I think yeah. Again the sharing.
Yeah, Kunti sir again.
I think it's by mistake it's happening.
Yeah, I know.
I'll go out and come in.
No, don't worry, sir. Just avoid click on that present now, bus. That's it. Don't worry, sir.
Okay.
You don't need to, doctor will share it. Yeah, it will happen.
Yeah.
Now, sir.
So this is a continuous mode which all birders should moreover think about and switch to. This is the AFC, autofocus continuing mode, wherein the camera, the lens focuses, the bird moves, it focuses again, the bird moves, it focuses again. And here you can use the burst mode also. If the bird is flying, you focus on the bird and start clicking, the move, do panning, move from left to right, right to left, your lens, the camera and the lens will focus, refocus, and you'll try to get good flight shots. There is one more, that is AFA, AF auto, which switches between the above two modes, but here you do not have any control. The camera decides on its own. So best to be avoided. In the Nikonians, there is one more. I don't know about the Canon. There is AL servo mode. And this is usually used by those
servo.
People. Hello?
Canon also AL servo, doctor.
Yeah, okay.
There is,
this is used especially by those people doing a lot of videography or the video. It focuses on a subject and keeps on focusing and tracking the subject as the subject moves. Just one thing is to be kept in mind. The first frame or the first time that you focus, the focus should be proper. If the focus is not proper in the first frame, then the subsequent focus will not be proper. Now we just actually learned about the focusing modes. Then the next thing comes is the focusing points. All the time you keep your camera screen in mind when you are clicking and when you are focusing. There are four types of focus points. The one is a single point or a single area, the dynamic or the whole, the auto, where the camera decides where to focus, and one is a 3D, when the bird or the butterfly or whatever is doing a zigzag, not in a single, you can say, motion. And these are camera focus points. These are very important. The single, multiple, all focus points, and a few focus points. If you are trying to capture a bird in flight, the best what I would suggest is use all the focus points. Because you focus a bird which is on a little bit right, and then you start clicking, the bird moves a little bit on the left. And if you are using single or a few focus points, a part of the bird can definitely go out of focus. So birds in flight, birds in action, I would prefer to use all the focus points. But there is a hitch. And what is the hitch? Using more focus points, the speed definitely goes slower. Focusing becomes slow. Single focus point is very fast. Few more addition, little bit less fast. Few more, still less fast. And all focus point is still less fast. But then you can bump up your ISO and try to achieve the desired results with this. This is again the same explained. One single. And this is the red, what you see is the focus, what you are, where you are focusing. That is what I was trying to explain. When you click a subject, please see to it that you avoid keeping the subject at the center of the camera screen or the center focus. You try to shift the focus to the left or to the right and compose your shots. Now, this is the Nikon camera where you can adjust your focus points, your focus modes. And this is the button where you attach your lens or you remove your lens by pressing this, and below that there is one button which is autofocus mode and a manual mode. As we talk about the two modes, and autofocus and the manual focus, but then below that there is one button which you have to press. You press this button and you move the dial to the left or the right, and this is how it happens. Now one more thing which I wanted to tell you. To get a sharp photograph, the most important thing what you require is a minimum amount of shutter speed. How much shutter speed? It depends upon the subject to subject, but birds basically require more shutter speeds. Birds in motion require still more shutter speeds. The thumb rule is that the shutter speed should be inversely proportional to the focal length of your lens. So if you are shooting with a 400 mm focal length, your shutter speed should be 400 mm. If you are zooming in and zooming out, keep that in mind. If it is 150 mm, your shutter speed should be 150. If it is a TC attached and your lens becomes 600 mm, the shutter speed should be 600. But there are some more aids that you can use to cut down on this. Now, why would you want to cut down? You can say, "Arey, if I'm getting good shutter speed, why I should cut down?" Well, to bump up the shutter speed, you need to increase the ISO, or you need to have a good light. If the light is not good, you need to bump up your ISO. Now, increasing the ISO may produce grains in your photographs. The moment there are more grains, the more ISO, the more grains. The more grains in your photographs, and if you are not able to remove them in post-processing, your photograph will get spoiled. So that's what we do. We try to keep the ISO low. So keep the ISO low, basically, and still getting a good shutter speed. Keep your camera and the lens on a tripod or a monopod. Better so on the tripod. Use a bin bag wherever possible. If you are using a tripod, you still see to it that you minimize the movement or the shake by keeping your hand on the lens. If possible, try to attach some heavy object to your tripod. If there is a hook on your tripod, try to attach something, some stone or some bag to your tripod, see to it that it pulls down and thus makes it more firm. See, this is what, if you have a good shutter speed, you get this. This is the next. That's a fish that is about to swallow. It's in the air. And this is about to swallow. Now we talked about lights. Let me elaborate a little bit more. Depending upon the light conditions, you have to adjust your camera to three metering modes. Now, what is metering? Metering decides how much of light that you are going to use on your subject, which is available. There are three in the Nikons and there are four in the Canon. I'll be talking about Nikon because I'm using Nikon. There is a matrix, there is a center weight, and there's a spot. Now, what is matrix metering? You click on a bird or you locate a bird. Bird is sitting in a bright area. You adjust your ISO, your exposure, minus or plus or whatever it is. And then you click a bird or you try to click a bird and suddenly the bird flies from there and goes and sits in a shade. All your settings are going to go wrong. There was ample light and now the light has become less. So the settings that you have done when the bird was in light was that of a low ISO, underexposure, and suddenly the bird goes and sits in the shade. If you click that, you won't be able to see the bird in your screen. It will be all dark, black, which you might not be recover later on. So what you can do is you can use this mode, the matrix mode. What does the matrix mode do is, matrix mode calculates the total amount of light that falls on your camera screen. Whatever the screen sees, the whole screen, whatever light that falls on this, the camera calculates that and then decides what is the average and then uses that. So you still have some relief if the bird shifts. Of course, if you can adjust your settings, that will still be much better, but this gives a bit of relief. Then the second is spot metering. Now, spot metering is what? Spot metering is what it decides about the light conditions on a particular spot. If the tiger or a bird is sitting in front of you, comfortably close, and if you point your lens onto a particular spot of that subject, the camera calculates the light on that part of the subject and then accordingly adjusts the settings. This is good actually if you use when the bird is sitting on an even light, like an open field or an, you can say, dry scrubby area, you can say areas like LRK, desert areas where the light is even. What the camera does is the light falling on the subject is calculated and distributed. What happens if you use this when there is less of contrast, when there's more of contrast, sorry, if there's more of contrast, for example, if the subject is in light and there is a darkness at the background, what will happen is the camera will calculate as ample of light and then it will cut down the light. What will happen is the background will become still dark. The third is center weight. What is center weight? It is almost like the spot metering, but the area is a bit bigger than the spot. This is more useful if the light is not falling directly on the subject. If it is falling from an angle or falling from behind, you can make amazing backlight pics with this center weight. One small setting which usually we overlook, we don't think about, is this diopter. Now, what is this diopter? See, this is very near your eyepiece or the viewfinder. This diopter is what those above 40 or those having specs, they can avoid using their specs when they are doing photography if they adjust this diopter. This diopter is for those people who have specs. You can move this, what you are saying is, dial to the left and the right, minus and plus, according to your specs number. You point your lens to an object. try to focus that without your glasses by moving this. If it is seen clearly, the subject is focused properly, that is the objection. Leave it, don't touch it again, and that's it. This you should use if you are having glasses. Pratamesh, any queries on this?
No, doctor, so far.
Okay. Then I am now going to share some photographs. This was a photograph which I made in Bharatpur way back in 2013-14. I was very new to photography. Thus, I got actually gray hair on killing a kingfisher. The kingfisher is still alive here, struggling to get away, and the gray heron has already pierced the kingfisher. This had appeared in the Century Asia magazine. A good article, 2 pages article, had appeared in Century Asia way back in 2013-14. A good shutter speed, good focus, this is what we get. The osprey. Again, requires a good shutter speed. This is a takeoff. This was worked out. Spotted owlets in Bharatpur. The owlets of the Indian scope owl. This was done in Bor Wildlife Sanctuary, Vidarbha. This is a hide photography. I was observing this, but I was not very keen to photograph because of this artificial perch. So I kept on waiting until I got these two flame backs in a frame. A good moment, I thought, and then I decided to click this. Way back when the ODK photographs were not very common like today, this was clicked and this gave me about one national and one state level award. Again, we are talking about the angle. This is the painted spur fall which I clicked in Hampi. We are waiting to see the sloth bears there. We saw a couple of painted spur falls. I decided to go down on the ground and get this ground level shot. Falcons, as you know, they are the fastest flyer, fastest birds.
Doctor, one minute. There is a question. I'll just read it out. You can decide whether you want to answer this now or later. Yes. I'll just read out the question. Sanjay Deshpande sir is asking, which is the setting to be used for all focus points? Is there any setting like this available actually?
All focus points?
Yes.
Well, all focus point has to be selected first. Secondly, as I told you, you have to decide where the bird is. If the bird is in open, what is the type of territory, the terrain, what it is. Then you select what metering mode you want. What else does he want to know?
That's it. Matlab, is there a setting like this actually exists? That is what he wants to know.
Yeah, birds in flight. If you want to click birds in flight or birds in motion, you should definitely select all the focus points. What will happen is, as I told, if you select a few focus points, bird moves, and if you don't capture them properly in those focus points, the bird will go out of focus.
Right.
The Lagar falcon. Falcons are fastest birds, as you all know. This was clicked, this takeoff was clicked in Bikaner outskirts. A good frame of a commoner, you can say. Coppersmith. But then again, some action. As being a hardcore wildlife photographer, tossing the berry and I could click it. What usually people do a mistake is, people keep on clicking and then they suddenly try to watch into the screen what happens, what have they clicked. And that is the time some action happens and they miss it. I've seen lots of people doing that. First thing is they keep on clicking in a burst mode and then suddenly they start watching it, what they have clicked, and that is the time they miss the action. What I would suggest is, when you go on a field, when you are waiting for the action to happen, just check your settings, make a pseudo click, check your settings, and then that's it. Once the action starts, please don't look into the screen, what you have clicked. Keep on clicking it, whatever it is, then move for post-processing later on. You might definitely move such sort of movements.
Doctor, okay, just a minute. Yeah. Before you start, just a quick thing. So what you're going to do is, if you have a question pertaining to a particular photograph, like for example, now doctor is going to talk about this particular photograph. If you have a question which is particular to this particular thing, you can ask it right away. But if you have any other question, what we can do is at the end of the session, we can ask it. Got it? So that's the reason. So if a particular image that has been shown, if you have a question, put it right away there so that it's easy for doctor to talk about it rather than going back to it later. Got it. So I think, doctor, we have a question regarding your Osprey image. I'll just read it out for you.
Okay.
Kajal sir is asking, what was the shutter speed of the Osprey image?
I'll have to go back. 1 sec. This one?
No, Osprey one.
Yeah, yeah, it's coming back.
Ah, yeah, there it is. Yeah.
This or the next one?
This one, I suppose. This. I think the Pope one.
Okay. I'll just show it on the screen. It's 1600. You can see the settings. 1600 was the shutter speed. The aperture was f9 and the ISO was 640. There was actually no need to go for this 640 ISO because the bird was an absolute open. It was bright sunny, but I still bumped up the ISO to 640 to get this shutter speed. I was anticipating some action, and this is action what I got.
Okay. Next one is the owl photograph that you have shared. What was the aperture setting for the owl?
Which owl?
Photograph. I think the spotted owlets, yes.
Okay. F8. 640 is the shutter. ISO again 640. There was a very funny story to this. This is a famous perch in Bharatpur. At the left side of the entrance of the Bharatpur bird sanctuary gate, there is a rest house, and outside the rest house, there is just acacia tree. And this tree has been made a home for spotted owlet. There were 5 on the tree, but they were not on a branch. 2 were together, 1 was on an adjacent branch, and 2 were on 2 different branches. Now, what we see on the screen is the extreme left and the extreme right are the parents, and the 3 are the owlets. I asked all my team members to stand with your cameras mounted on a tripod and be ready. I made a call. As I made a call, the 3rd owlet was scared and came and sat beside its siblings. They started shouting, calling the parents. And in a fraction of a second, both the parents also came and sat beside. So we could get 5 in a frame. Now, a few people can say, why playing call? Well, that's a different thing. If any query is there, I'll answer. But I would best try to avoid that because there can be different opinions about that. Can you forward?
Yes, yes, let's avoid.
Now we click this, 5.
Yeah.
There was no call played here because there were only these outlets. No parents were there. Initially, the one at the back with orange eyes, that was the only one there. It was watching us, and from inside, these 2 more outlets popped up and we got 3 in a frame. this is a full frame image. We were very close. If we were in fact looking for a tiger, and we could get. We're talking about this lagar. There is a bit of lag on the this thing.
Right, doctor. Yeah. Maybe the internet Sunday evening, no?
Yeah.
There's a question on this photograph as well. I think probably first you can talk and then I'll ask the question.
Yeah.
Regarding the seagull photograph.
Seagulls, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you can.
Okay, I'll read out the question. What was for the brown-headed gull picture? I presume 3D focal point setting was used.
Not really, because they are in the same angle. They are in the same dimension. So 3D was not used. This was matrix mode. So that's using the whole screen, and all the focus points were used.
No questions. I think we can move ahead.
Yeah. Again, a very simple frame, but in a nice frame. This was again made in Bighorn. Bighorn is a very good place to make nice action shots of wetland birds. Grey heron. One of my favorite photographs I made last year, last rainy season, when we went to Nalsarovar for the little bittern. We went to the adjacent fields and we got the Saras cranes making a display. Now you should keep in mind when is most likely that you get a display of the Saras cranes. Saras cranes, when they are approaching their nest, they are most likely to make a display. So if you locate a nest, if you are waiting there, that is one thing. Or if there is the courtship going on, that's another thing when you get display modes. This was made in Bharatpur last year. Most birders from Mumbai must have seen the next photograph. Rotamesh, I hope you had seen this.
Yes, I know, sir. Still in the wish list. I missed it twice.
Yeah, this is the Great Bittern. And this had come to Mumbai in a deserted, or you can say, a dump yard or a dump wetland in Kandivli. And this was spotted in Mumbai after a gap of 78 years, I think. Before independence, it was noted here. And then 3 years back, it was there for a couple of days. Lots of photographs were there, but all the photographs of the bird were that the bird was hidden in the reeds. I too was just going there for a record shot, but lucky me, the moment I went there, clicked a few shots, the bird suddenly came onto the open. And I could get this also, the next shot. It's nice to see a lagar falcon making a dive to catch a prey.
Doctor, I have some questions. One is regarding the bulbul frame, the red waistcoat bulbul frame. The bulbuls are looking different in the different directions. So should we be still following the rule of the third or the center is better in a case of that bulbul frame?
One sec. Yeah, I'll tell you what. Now, of the two bulbuls, which of the bulbul I can make out is doing some action or is more attracting is the one with the cherry, with the berry, sorry. So I kept space in front of that. That is more important to me than the bulbul which is just sitting on the perch. You decide when there are two or more subjects, you decide which is the subject of focus and then accordingly you frame. to me, I thought the bulbul with the berry is more important. So I kept space more in front of that.
There's another question regarding the Saras crane image.
Yeah.
What were the focus points for Saras crane calling image? I mean, was it single or was it all point?
No, it was not single. It was again all points. Because the Saras was in motion, I was not sure where the Saras I will get in the frame. So I wanted to come, I wanted that to come in the frame. So all focus points were used. Usually a single focus point I use when the bird is small, bird is in good light, and bird is in even light behind, in front and around the bird. I use a single focus point. But here the birds are big, so I use all the focus points.
Doctor, we have a very interesting question. Again, it goes back to the osprey image.
Yeah.
I'll read it out. It's by Vivek Amrute. Hi, initially it was mentioned about the shutter speed should be equal to the focal length. Now, with the osprey pick, the shutter speed is around 1600. So, how to take this call? It's a bright light, yet 640 ISO. So, can you explain the reasons for using this setting? Newer cameras are also allowing higher ISO without much noise. So, how to use it just to ensure you get a better picture?
I just want to know what question was about the ISO.
It's a bright light, yet the ISO was 640.
Yeah, I'll tell you how it is. See, the shutter speed should be inversely proportional to the focal length. Now, what focal length I was using that time was 300 mm 2.8 with 1.7 TC. That was giving me around 640 or 650 or something. So, the minimum shutter speed what was required was around that. But if I get more shutter speed, I am more likely to freeze and get a sharp image. The more shutter speed, the more sharp the image is going to be. But at the same time, how much more you can increase? For that, you have to keep an eye on the ISO and see to it that you cannot increase to that extent that there are grains in the image. Now, because I was using a bit high-end camera, D500, I had the liberty of using a little bit more ISO. D500 gives very less grains. It is just as good as a full-frame camera. So I had the liberty of using that. But those using consumer lens cameras or mid-range cameras, they definitely should keep in mind that if you increase the ISO, they are going to be grains. Now, why there are no grains in my frame is that D500 allows to use high ISO. And I wanted the most possible shutter speed because I wanted to the image to be tack sharp. So the more the shutter speed, the image is going to be more sharp. I hope that's satisfying.
Yes, doctor. Yes. Doctor, let's do one thing. Let's take the questions at the end because I think what will happen is we will end up talking about it. It's already 7:30. So let's finish up with your session first and then we'll take the questions at one go. We can always come back to the images.
Okay. This is a classic example when I was not using all the focus points. I was using less number of focus points and two birds in flight. One goes out of focus and one is in focus. Had I used all the focus points, I probably might have got both the birds in focus. So the bird on the right is more in focus. The left is not that much in focus. The next frame is a classic example of using the aperture. Not very far off from the bird, but not very close either. But then behind the bird, there was a clutter. There were some thorny bushes. This was again clicked in Bikaner outskirts. Steppy Eagle was about to take off. We were watching it and waiting, anticipating some action. But I realized if I want action, if I want a bird sharp, what I would want to do is I would want to increase the aperture to F9, 10, 11. But doing that, I might get the bird sharp, but bushes, the branches, thorny branches behind the bird, they might also become sharp in the frame. So the frame might lose the interest. So what I did was we moved a little bit away from the bird, kept a comfortable distance, And then I increased the aperture to 5.6. From F7, F9, I came down to 5.6. I got the bird in good focus. And then you see what's behind that is not in focus. And again, a classic example of using all the focus points. This is not a cropped image. The brown-winged kingfisher was very close. We were almost touching our boat to the branch where the brown-winged kingfisher was. And using a few focus points, I might have lost this frame. I got this tack sharp because it used all the focus points. Sometimes you move so close that you lose some part of the bird. That is the only reason why I kept this image in the slideshow. The crab plover, the parent is feeding the young one. Again, what I told, approach to the bird is very important. Those who have been to Andaman must have seen this Andaman teal. They are very shy. If you try to move close, they'll move far off. This is a bit crop, not a very full frame, but not much crop, maybe 20% crop. That's it. A good approach will definitely give you this frame. Approaching is very important. The angle is very important. Lying down sometimes can give you a very good frame. The Indian eagle owl. Shonkhalia. Me and my friend Dr. Atul Deshpande, we used to frequent the Thane Creek for many, many years. The initial few years, we were making all sorts of messy photographs, up and down, not in a horizontal frame, whatever. And then we tried to improvise seeing them. This has been clicked at a very low level. We were almost leaping onto a small boat and tried to get this photograph. So the angle is very important. It generates the interest of the viewer in the frame. Then again, using multiple focus points, using a good shutter speed, if the bird is close, you can get this frame. This was hardly cropped, hardly. Again, getting very close to a very shy bird. Almost just 20% crop. Black neck grebe clicked in Jamnagar. Your frame also should look interesting. Try to click, even if you're doing height photography, try to make an image which generates interest. The spider hunter, little spider hunter, was sitting on this flower, looks an interesting frame, isn't it? And the greater crested grebe. This also usually doesn't allow you to come close. We try to hide ourselves behind some bushes and let the bird come close so that we could click it. Again, clicking birds, a few things you should keep in mind is if you try to get some data or some information, great knot, which we clicked in Jamnagar, at this band. It's not an Indian or BNHS band, it's an international band. And we could click this and we could send the info to the origin country. This is one of the very rare birds. We were very lucky to get this. But then, not just lucky, there were some points that you need to keep in mind when you click such sort of birds. This is a terrestrial bird, a ground bird. This never comes in open if it gets disturbed. Believe me, we were 9 people sitting in front of this bird, just about a few feet away. And not just one, there was a pair. But since I had a long focal length, I could just get one bird in the frame. This is very hardly cropped. I'll show you the next, which is uncropped. Just for the composition and to avoid the clutter. This was in a garbage area. To avoid that garbage and generate interest, I cropped it about 10 or 12% or 15%. What happens is these birds are ground birds. So if you are at a distance, if you move, the vibration of the ground is realized by the birds and the birds go into hiding. They will never come into the open. So it is not always necessary that you should use the camouflage clothes. You should not talk. You should not whisper. This is also important. If the bird is terrestrial, you see to it that you don't vibrate the ground, especially if you are in a very silent zone. That vibration of the ground can disturb the bird. It absolutely came so close. At a moment, I thought it's going to come onto the lens. Yeah, this is the actual frame. This is the original frame. You can see the bird was not at all far. And just to avoid this blue thing, the plastics, I just cropped this and got this frame. Again, a very interesting frame and an interesting bird. Next is a McQueen's bustard. Believe me, I had been to LRK 6 times. And I could just see this bird from a distance, but I could never click this. So one day I just sat down and I thought, why am I not getting this bird? I made a study and then I realized this bird is very shy. I had actually experienced this. The bird is very shy. The moment we try to approach the bird, it flies off. You never get any shots. So what I did is, birders, please keep this in mind. This bird is a migratory bird into the LRK. It comes from the Gulf, Pakistan and allied countries. It comes into the LRK at the beginning of winter season. You can say November beginning, November first week, October end, these birds come here. And that is the time when there's a lot of wet grounds there in the LRK. So tourists still haven't started going there. That is time if you go, you can get this bird. But mind well, the migratory birds, other migratory birds, the raptors haven't arrived by that time. So if you go for these birds, you might most likely not get anything else. I attempted this. We could see 10 McQueen's bustards in 2 days or less than 2 days. And we got a very good close-up also, which you can see. But then we hardly got anything else during that trip. But then the tour members were told, we are going for this. Keep this in mind. The next is the GRK, sorry, this is a Great Indian Bustard. One of the very last photographs from Nalia. This was not in GRK. Sorry, this is not in DNP. Usually now only DNP and some places in Karnataka which haven't been disclosed by the Forest Department. But DNP is the only place where now you get to see the GIBs, the Great Indian Bustards. But this was before that. We clicked this in Nalia. And we clicked it from a distance of just a few feet. They were there in front of us, undisturbed for about 40-45 minutes. Uncropped image, full frame. And we moved close. We got one more still closer frame. This is a little bit cropped also. Again, a very shy bird in Andaman, which is always hidden in the bushes. You hardly get this, but those who have been to Andaman will realize they hardly get this bird in the open. It's an Andaman cockle. So the approach is very important. One more good action shot. Again, a good ground level shot. We got in Bikaner was this common kestrel was feasting on a desert jerd. This photograph has given me quite a few awards, national and international. We were talking about the number of focus points to be selected. All the focus points were selected here. This is again uncropped image. Again, a very shy bird, endemic just to the mountains of Hampi. The yellow-throated bulbul. Very shy bird. Wetland birds are very difficult to approach, but then if you crawl, if you don't disturb the birds, you can get very good close-up too. A commoner, a reddish shank, but I just thought this is a very good frame because of the tail angle, tail feathers. And something that you get in and around the city also. This was clicked in Thane city proper. This was clicked in Majivda in a complex, Loda complex, Eurasian hobby. You can make some beautiful artistic frames also when you do birding. So, birder friends, you, if you are thinking about the photography angle, you should decide what you really want to do with your photographs. You want to just put them on the social media, you want to participate in competitions, want to use them in books, periodicals, magazines, want to write an article. Accordingly, you should decide and click. Most people have been told, we have been told, go and click just in RAW. And then you can do whatever you want to in post-processing. Now, let me tell you, wildlife competitions are not allowing much of post-processing. Hardly cropping, dodging, removing of dust, only this much is allowed. If you add, if you subtract more without cropping, if you add an element, it is not allowed. So what is the point in clicking RAW if you are not allowed post-processing? Second point I wanted to tell you, some people, even I used to do that, I used to click with JPEG as well as RAW. Now one JPEG image is about almost 15 MBs. A RAW image is about 23 to 25 MBs. So total it becomes about 40 MBs. What you, most people use is a card of 48 Mbps. That means a data of 48 MBs can be clicked in a second. Now if your card is can click only 48 and you are doing JPEG plus RAW, and if you want an action shot, all the shots, if your camera is having 6 frames per second or 10 frames per second, your card will not allow that. And there will be a lag and you're going to miss everything. So if you want to do action photography, you buy a card with at least 94 or 128 Mbps. Or if you have a card with just 48 Mbps, and if you want to click all the action shots, please avoid RAW and go for just JPEG. 13 MB photograph, you can click 5 or 6 photographs in a second and you can get all the action shots. One more artistic frame about the golden flame bag. And once you are done with bird photography, please leave the birds, go away from them, don't disturb them. Pratamesh? Hello?
Yes, doctor. Yes, doctor.
If time permits, I want to show the kingfishers. If no time, then we'll conclude here.
Let's do the kingfisher, yes. That's okay.
Okay.
Let's see. We'll do it quickly, but let's do the kingfishers because they're quite interesting.
Okay. Yeah. As you all know, there are a bird called kingfisher exists. There are 12 types of kingfishers, which might most of you might not know, or some of you might not know another. This is the kingfisher which most of us have seen and photographed. The commonest one, but is not called the common kingfisher. This is a white-throated or the white-breasted kingfisher, which you usually see perched on an overhead wire or on a fence at the countryside or just outside the city. This was the first kingfisher which I clicked, which everyone clicks usually when they go out for photography, the white-throated kingfisher. This is the second, that is a small blue kingfisher, but this is called common kingfisher. It is definitely not as common as the white-throated, but still it is called common kingfisher. Probably abroad it is more common, and the nomenclatures come from there. So this is called common kingfisher. Again, an interesting frame made across the Zawari River of the same kingfisher. The pied kingfisher, third kingfisher, which I clicked in Bharatpur. What is a pied? Whatever that is black and white is called a pied. So this is a pied kingfisher. The pied kingfisher has a very interesting habit. It locates its prey and then it keeps hovering until it locates it properly and then makes a dive. It catches its prey, usually a fish, and then it goes and perches itself somewhere and starts enjoying it. So this is perch. There is no meal in the beak. Probably has finished it before we reached. The collared kingfisher. This was clicked in the Sundarbans. You get this in Goa also, across the Zawari. You get this at Bitharkanika also. You get this in Andaman. So four places to get this. This was clicked in Andamans. The fourth most colorful, most interesting, most liked. Wherever you put a photograph of this bird on any social media, you're definitely going to get at least 50 to 100 likes, a few comments. There was a time when this was very rare, one of the rarest and difficult most to get. But now you get this very easily and one of the most easiest kingfisher to get. But this you can get mostly only during the rainy seasons, right from Panvel to Goa. You get this in Andamans also. We call click this in Andamans. Incidentally, I wish to tell you one thing. The difference between the birds of Andaman or the kingfishers of Andaman and in general all the birds of Andamans and the mainland is the birds of Andamans, the kingfishers of Andaman are a little bit smaller in size as compared to the mainlands. Would you care with just one more feed the crab? This is my favorite screen, which is coming up, and Prathamesh is also the blue-eared kingfisher. This is just the second time that I'm displaying this frame. I displayed this frame in one of my previous webinar. This is the second time a courtship going on of the blue-eared kingfishers. The one on the right side is the male carrying a fish and trying to propose the female. The female doesn't seem to be interested. And what really happened is, female did not respond for almost 1 month. That was the story of this. There was a nest built, but that was neglected because there was no mating and the female was just not interested. I reached there, this was in Chikulun, Guwahagar. I reached there. And one fine morning, I just went and sat in the hide. Before the activity starts, I just went there and I got to click this. The stock-billed kingfisher, one of the big kingfishers, very interesting, beautiful. This was clicked again across the Zawari. The black cap. Used to call this Kala Topi. Black cap, you get, I clicked this in Sundarbans, but you get this across Zawari also. You get this across Bitharkanika, but a more bit difficult there. And you get this in Andamans. Yes, of course, there's a record of my own self having clicked this black cap kingfisher across Thane Creek way back in 2013-14. You get this in Dombili also, Vasai, Tungareshwar, but not very common. The brown-winged kingfisher, which I have already shown you. This was again in Bitharkanika. Bitharkanika is the best place to see this. This is called the jewel of Bitharkanika. You get beautiful frames and close-ups in Bitharkanika. To some extent, you can see in Sundarbans, but not that easy as in Bitharkanika. And then comes the largest kingfisher, of India, the crested kingfisher. This is usually found in north and the northeast. This one was clicked in Arunachal, but you also get this in and around Satal Pangot. The ruddy kingfisher, one of the rare kingfishers, very rare. Very rarely to get in Sundarbans. A bit more easier, but not easy in Andamans. I attempted in Sundarbans two times, once in December, once in the rainy season. Did not get in December, got in rainy season, but just a record thing. We saw it flying off, but we could not click it. Then Andamans, two tours we made, and the second tour we got a good one. This is in the habitat, and this was a close-up that we got. Quite close. This was a bit cropped for composition and to remove the disturbing elements, but was very close, a few feet away just. And the rarest of it all, the Bliss Kingfisher. And this was clicked at the outskirts of Pakhe, in between Assam and Arunachal. Then again, there's a very interesting story for this. We went there to click this bird in an area which was closed for tourism for almost 8 years. A photographer who had been there 8 years back was kidnapped by the Bodos, and ever since that area was closed for bird photography. Then we decided to go there, but we were not sure when to go. For almost 2-3 months, we were deciding. And then I came across one aspect of bird photography, which I want to share with you all. I was trying to gain all information as to when to go there from a few people who had already clicked, but nobody was giving me the right information as to when to go there for photography, which is the right time to go there, which is the right season when there can be little less rains, when the weather can be a bit more predictable, when to go. We were not getting any feedback, so we decided we'll go in November. We reached there, and after reaching there, when we settled down, the first thing we learned that there were 8 groups which have come in the last 2 months, ever since this area has been opened, but they have not got this. So we started on a very negative note. But then, okay, as we have already reached there, now what can be done? We'll try for this. First 2 days, no sight. Third day, we got a glimpse of this bird flying across the streams. In the northeast, the rivers are very fast flowing. They are not very deep, but they are very fast flowing. And since you have to wade across these rivers, there are those big rocks, and you have to wade across them. They are slippery and they are full of leeches. So by the time when you reach to your room in the evening, each of us had at least 4 or 5 leeches attached to the feet. We had to pull them off, and the room used to be full of blood. On the 5th day, we again saw this bird. We were in the stream through the fast-flowing river, and we saw this bird flying across. We thought we have lost it, and that's it. That was the second last day, but we thought we are not going to get it. And suddenly, this bird perched on a big rock. That was the chance. This was there for just 5 to 7 seconds. We made, each of us made about 5-7 friends. That's it. And the bird flew off, and that was in November 2018, my 12th and the last kingfisher. So, is there any more time?
No, I think, Dr. Avad, it's already about 8 o'clock. We'll take up the questions.
Okay.
Just a minute. Yeah, 1 minute. I'll just stop the recording as well. Participants, if you have any questions.